of the living boot.
Hello and welcome to this week's LHG podcast. I'm Nick. That's Jake.
Hello.
There's Connor.
Boop.
What?
What?
All right.
That's
Taylor.
Mwah.
That was my reggae intro.
All
right.
All right. A great way to start a podcast. Yep. So this week has been pretty slow today. This week's been pretty slow.
News-wise,
we played a lot of games though, and
that's true.
Yeah, and Jake actually played Mad Max.
I did play a little bit of Mad
Max. So let's hear his impressions. We all know what he talked about last week.
Yeah. He was afraid that it would be like Shadow of Mordor. Was his fear? Why you were hesitant?
And Taylor, who had played it, contended that it was not.
Mm-hmm. And
am I right?
You correct. Also liked Shadow of Mordor.
I did.
Right, and I did too.
Well, I didn't like love it, but it wasn't.
I liked it.
Yeah, it was an enjoyable game.
That's kind of where I'm at. I liked it, right. And that's kind of what I thought of Mad Max. There was really nothing about the game that was bad, honestly. It just, none of it was, like, exciting. I had no interest to continue playing.
Didn't spark you?
Never. And now, granted, I had a really stressful week last week, and I got it from Redbox. And so every day, you know, it kind of was building up, you know, financially and all this stuff in my head. So for whatever reason, the $3 a day for Redbox was like freaking me out, right? So I'm like, I got to play this today.
It was almost like an obligation kind
of,
right?
So like I got home and there was tons of other stuff I had to do. So it was like, it was rushing. And then it's like, you know, once I finally got my list of stuff to do that day after work done, then I went home and was like, okay, Mad Max, like, I gotta play it, I gotta enjoy it. Enjoy this, Jake, right? So then I started playing, and like, it could have been, honestly, the stress, you know, that could have just not let me really
enjoy it,
yeah.
Just like punching yourself in the head, enjoy this!
But
enjoy it!
At the same time, so the vehicle combat was awesome. I liked that. It was kind of weird always. Like, do you always bring around Chum?
That guy, yeah.
He's always with you? That's a little weird. Mm. Like, I kind of like having him because he repairs stuff.
Yeah.
And he's kind of, you know, your Cortana. He's your quest progressor, right?
Mm-hmm.
But, like, having him, like, you can make this awesome-looking car, but every car, I'm assuming, is going to have some sort of bed that he stands in.
Sure, yeah.
And so it's kind of like every car you have, no matter how cool it's going to look, he's just going to be chilling in the back of it, and he's going to take up, like, and he's going to block your view of, like, you know, a third of your car because he's standing in the back of it. So it's like, you're just kind of watching this dude's hump back and just kind of.
That's true. I didn't really think of that.
I don't know. I was like, I don't know. It's just kind of strange. And in general, like, none of the characters that I've met so far were anywhere near interesting. Mad Max, especially, was just really dull. Like, I haven't seen either movie, so I don't know what kind of character he is, you know, before this game. But, like, he was just a dick to everyone, and he kind of just could get anything done. There was really nothing ever standing in his way. So it's just kind of like, oh, okay,
yeah,
I guess.
That's kind of Mad Max. He doesn't really talk in the movies.
But that's what I'm saying, is that, like, it didn't make it interesting. There was nothing, there was nothing for him to overcome. There were no, like, difficult things for him to do. It's just like, oh, okay, I have to do that. I'll just go do that then. And I'm like, oh, well, all right, I guess he's just going to go do that. And he's perfectly capable of doing it. So
yeah,
I felt like I didn't even have to do anything as the player. I was like, I don't have to help this character out at all.
So he's like Action Hank.
Yeah, yeah, like Action Hank. Exactly. You know, like, and I'm just little
he's
Dexter.
He's so
there.
Rugged. But yeah, it's kind of like when we were talking about, like, we had some examples last week, like Ip Man, where it's like you knew the whole movie that he was just going to kick everybody's ass.
Yeah.
So, like, there's no drama.
And he didn't have to really go through any growth to do that. He had to go through hardships.
Right.
Right. And I guess in that movie,
maybe the
obstacle was, you know, he's so good at fighting, but he's, you know, maybe not as good at being
able
to just,
exactly.
You know,
there's some
live
other
every
kind
day.
Of issue.
But, like, Mad Max, there was just really, he didn't really have any problems besides the first problem in the game, which, you know, all the trailers showed.
I want my car back.
Yeah, all the trailers showed, you know, you start the game with nothing and you have to build it all up from there. But it's like his only problem was that one you saw in the cutscene. The rest of the game is just him succeeding again. You know, it's just not like, oh, well, this is interesting. Like, Just kidding. Yeah.
It's that's a totally fair complaint. And I feel like Mad Max is sort of a weird property in that sense to try to make a game out of, because one, like, if you've watched like Road Warrior, he literally has like 12 lines in that movie, like the whole movie.
Right.
And in Fury Road, like, he doesn't talk much, and he's like, you. Here. He talks like a caveman, kind of. It's kind of bizarre.
Huh.
I don't know. I guess that's understandable.
Yeah.
I figured it was a game that not everybody was going to like, but...
Well, and so again, though, sorry. So to get it back on track, mm-hmm. it did remind me a lot of Shadow of Mordor, just in the sense that I think it's just the genre. You know, it's in the same way
Open world syndrome?
Well, that Fallout reminds me of Oblivion, or Fallout 3 reminded me of Oblivion, right? Because they just, even though they're totally different worlds... Right,
it's the
just
same
the
shit.
Gameplay and the genre and all that. It's really similar, obviously. Yeah. I mean, and that's kind of an extreme example, considering it's the same engine, the same company. I mean, that's right. an extreme example. Yeah. But really, like in Shadow of Mordor, I just kind of felt like, okay, there are a bunch of territories in this open world, and I'm starting in this one. I'm gonna go kind of, you know, destroy. Like, I'm going to, destroy the enemy's influence over the area, which is going to allow my allies to have more little spots. Right. And, you know, I'm going to increase my abilities so I can kick more ass. And
so you can explore more of the open world.
Yeah, exactly.
Assassin's Creed.
Yeah, it was the same thing. It's just instead of running, you were driving. You know, and
that's
just,
fair.
I just didn't, yeah.
To go, what's funny is, though, so if we're going to, I want to rewind a bit. Batman, for all intents and purposes, does that, but I feel like the story moments make it way more interesting.
Yes.
When it has those like cool, like core story moments, it does it way better either of those.
And I think that the Batman is less open world. It's mm-hmm. not like you have an entirely humongous, like, you know, the Great White or Mordor. You know, you just have a city, three districts. That's it. It's like, in that sense, a smaller game is better. Because, you know, I think if Batman was... Like, if they made the map, like, four times as big as it is currently, I wouldn't like it as much.
Just be an annoyance.
It would just be like, okay, there's so much to do, and it's just, I don't even, where do I even begin?
We need to play Metal Gear Solid 5 and compare it to this.
Yeah, we do. Well, we were going to get to that, but...
To be fair, I do think Metal Gear Solid 5, from everything I've seen and heard, even though I haven't actually played a Metal Gear Solid game before, mm-hmm. I can't imagine it's going to have the same scene. It looks like it's so much more polished, and it's so much more in depth, and the characters and story and everything is so much more.
Yeah,
I can't imagine it's gonna have the same kind of blah syndrome that those two did.
Like, from what I understand, it's a game that gives you a toolbox, and it's like, we're not gonna tell you how to finish this mission. Like, the mission objectives apparently are like really basic. It's like, rescue this guy, but there's like, how many million ways can you rescue this guy? Do you want to kill everybody? Do you want to try to be stealthy? Do you want to try to Fulton them all out? Like,
you're tickling me right now.
Yeah,
that's nice. So it's not like, you know, hey, it's like the whole level is about rescuing the guy, but you know, the first objective, you know, kill the guards in front. Second objective, enter the building. Third objective, find a way into the vents.
To the last room and do the thing.
Yeah.
And
it's assassinate this guy. Here's this whole area where this guy might be in.
Right.
Yeah. See, that I can get down with, because I like when games like just exactly just give you the tools and just like, all right, good luck, you son of a bitch. You know, like,
yep. Exactly.
That's what it should be in all games.
Sure.
Or not all games, but games of that variety.
Yep. Totally.
Is it already put away in the red box?
Yeah, I only spent $3 on it.
Okay. R.I.P. Someone starts shoveling
the dirt. You know what? At least you gave it a shot.
And yeah, because it did sound cool, and I'm actually glad I tried it, because I was curious enough about it where it kind of would have bugged me if I never tried it. And I think, honestly, someday I really may pick it up if I'm just in the mood for that kind of thing. Just kind of what would the genre be? It's like it's an open world action adventure, maybe.
Yeah, the core is like, like car battles, but open world action.
Oh yeah, open not adventure, because adventure is kind of not open world usually.
When I think of adventure, I think of like Telltale games or something.
Oh okay, yeah. So it's just open world action, and it's just there's sometimes I'll be in the mood for it.
So it sounds like Mad Max is like synthesized from tons of different styles of games. Like,
yeah,
and never, a lot of different elements present.
Yeah, it takes inspiration from a lot of different things. Never does any one thing unique. I said, it was a perfect time filler, but it's not like the game that's like, oh man, I can't wait for Mad Max X. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
It's just a fun thing to play.
And I think the combat, also, sorry, just I totally forgot about this. Combat, you know, maybe a small thing I should probably talk about.
Yeah.
It just kind of sucked.
You have to really unlock some other abilities before it gets interesting. Like, the beginning is real dull.
And I think the problem is that because it's so similar to Batman. Now, this is kind of an interesting problem that they had, because the reason that I didn't like the combat is because Batman's combat spoiled me. And because they're so similar to each other, because it's so much, it's very much like the same tactics you'll use in the Batman, you know, games and this one, because it's really the same. It's like, you know, do your attacks, do your heavy attacks, and then press a button to counter, right? And
so it's not very inspired.
No, like it's not the... inspired, but because of that, because it's so similar to Batman, I can't not draw comparisons, and I can't not say, wow, right. This sucks compared to Batman.
Well, he has so many less tools at his disposal, right? Like, well, the one thing I like about Batman is you can jump over guys or whatever and, like, get behind him, and you can't do that.
So what I'm saying is that I think that in order, because they can't, just saying that, oh, well, if you just stop comparing it to Batman and just look at our combat system in, you know, on its own.
It's like you're doing the same thing.
But that's what I'm saying is that, yeah, I think they can't be ignorant to that. They can't just... you know, want people to not compare it to Batman. Like, I think because it's so similar, if they wanted to do that,
then
fine.
Do something else.
Yeah, they have to differentiate it more then, so that I'm not just instantly thinking this is just crappy Batman.
Yeah.
You know? So.
Fair enough.
Anyway, that was it. Sorry.
No, it's cool. I'm glad we're good to get differing opinions. On
Mad
the
Max
game.
With Bayonetta combat.
Dude, that'd be amazing. An open world, well, that's supposedly what Scalebound's going to be, right? Like an open world game with
hopefully
Bayonetta combat. We'll see.
It'd be cool. It looks fun.
Yeah, we shall see about that when the time comes. So on MGS5, as far as the status of people at this table who have and have not played it, I own it now officially.
Hey.
But yeah, hey, woo! But it hasn't made it into my PS4 yet because, like, Metal Gear Solid, it's one of those games where no matter what iteration it is, like, it's kind of intimidating because it's so, like, emotionally and mentally taxing. And I say that in, like, the most endearing way.
Yeah.
Like, mm-hmm. But it's an investment, and you gotta be ready. You can't go in there, you know, just flying by the seat of your pants right. Playing Metal Gear Solid.
Yeah, just like, oh, I have an hour. I might as well start it up.
That's
yeah.
not no. gonna work. That's not gonna work.
You gotta have an afternoon off. It's gotta be raining.
Right?
Yeah, exactly. It has to be on the anniversary of the death of a loved one.
But I feel like that's the same. It's the same way with, like, Telltale's The Walking Dead. I haven't started season 2 yet because season 1 was just such a dramatic and such an amazing, just outstandingly powerful.
It's like the better it
ending.
Is, the more intimidating
it is. Yeah, I'm just like,
I
don't even know when I'm going to be in the mood to start up season 2 because although I loved season 1 and I have nothing against season 2 and I want to play it, I just can't find myself. Every time I'm like, oh, I could start up 2. No, I...
Like, you got to be in the like, right mood, right?
I can't do it right
now. Because if you're not prepared, it'll just crush your soul.
Yeah, yeah.
But, this week, I promise... Sorry to cut you off. This week, I promise I'm going to wrestle with MGS5 in a kiddie pool full of KY jelly, and I'll have some serious answers for you next week.
Nice.
I'll try not to hype you up for The Taken King, which comes out tomorrow. Well, right. It'll actually already be out when you listen to this.
I might...
Guys... I'll see you on The Taken King. I'm playing right now, by the way.
If I get into Destiny, I might die. So just careful what you want to, you know, be responsible for. Think about that.
If you get him into Destiny, he'll flunk out of school. Oh, we don't want that.
It's all on you, dude. It's all on you.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
Your future is in it.
I won't hype it up for you until you've put in, like, at least
80 hours.
50 hours into Metal Gear Solid.
Her life is in your hands, dude.
Oh, God.
Her life is in your hands. But, yeah, so that is my pledge to my game team here, the LHG team, that I will have solided the gear metal by next time.
Solidified?
Solidified. I will be the tangible Viper by next time. Yes.
Nice. Wonderful.
Yes. Okay, so...
Anyway, I might buy it soon, too.
Well, for our topics today, moving past that, by the way, buy it so we can talk about it.
Yeah.
But for our topics today, we don't have too much in the way of news, so we just have two big kind of open-ended discussions.
Oh, wait, we do have one more thing.
What? Throw it at me.
Super Mario Maker review.
Oh, yeah, dude. Let's have it.
What do you mean not yet? You've been playing it. Come on, we got to talk about it.
I like it right now, all right? We'll talk about it next week when all of you guys have played it.
Okay.
All right.
You know what? All right.
Okay.
Because Nick's been making some levels, and we'll have played them, and we'll have been able to...
I'll probably be dead by then.
It'll be a better discussion if we have all, you know, dipped our toe in the waters.
Can we record me trying out these levels tonight?
We can if you want.
That'd be good. Boom. I like that. Okay, so pretty much the plan right now is that after we finish this podcast, I'm going to try out some of the levels he's made. So we'll try and record those, and then you guys can watch them.
I mean, when Taylor was playing last night, yeah. he was like,
"Yeah, Nick will drink your tears."
He's getting really mad.
Your sorrow sustains him.
No, well, I look forward to it. But okay, cool. So sorry, good Connor, luck. What you were saying? You said we had two big what now?
Two open-ended topics to discuss today, that both of which are very fun. So, Nick, why don't you go ahead and say the first one?
All right. So, we will be talking about our favorite boss battles of all time.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah. So,
I don't know. I think it's interesting. You know, we talk about these open world games. I feel like boss battles have become less of a thing. Like,
totally.
early on, it was like, oh, what was the final boss like?
Yeah,
or whatever.
Exactly.
And I think it was really funny to watch, like, the PS3 generation, because they were struggling with that, right? Like, okay, we got to put a final boss because that's just how games are, right?
Yep,
like, in Arkham Asylum, there was a dumb Joker boss.
Yeah.
And it's like, we got to have a boss battle,
right? That
was
a little weird.
Let's make a juggernaut Joker.
Yeah.
The good news is that it did tie in with the rest of the series, but they could have done it without making it so weird.
Right,
like,
totally.
It was weird.
And then another that comes to mind, too, that was really bad was the ending of Uncharted 2, where you have to, like, blow up all those, like, plants and stuff.
That was pretty hard, though.
It wasn't fun. The whole game was fun up until, like, the very end. But anyway, we're talking about our favorite boss battles. And I want to toss one out here, because I know you guys are sort of dwelling.
Kick it off. Yeah, I'm pontificating real hard right now.
So the one that immediately comes to mind, I know you guys haven't played this game, but in Shadow of the Colossus, the game...
I've watched that whole game from start to finish.
Oh, okay.
My friend Richard played it, and I was just, like, over the shoulder the whole time, so I feel like I kind of achieved
the
experience.
So you know what it's about.
Yeah, and I understand. Yeah, I understand. Basically.
So for the uninitiated, Shadow of the Colossus is essentially just one giant game about boss battles. Like, you go around, like, the game sort of points you in the direction, you have to find them, and it doesn't tell you how to beat them, you just have to beat them.
You just run up to this giant dude and you're like, I guess I'll try this.
Yeah, exactly. It's a lot of trial and error, but once you get close to their weak spot, it starts glowing. But anyway, my favorite boss battle in Shadow of the Colossus is this one. It's like a bird, and it appears out of the sand, and like the way you have to like even start attacking is you ride on your horse, and like he like tilts on the side or something like that, and then you're able to jump off your horse onto his wing, and then you're like climbing on his wing as he's flying. He's like turning upside down, and it's like freaking insane. It's so crazy. And because like you're like struggling to hold on, like you have this grip meter and you just don't want to fall off. So like when he turns back over, you like kind of regain your strength and stuff. Like, I hate this word is like so overused, but it was like truly epic. Like, it was like one of like the real boss battles I could say is epic.
Right.
Like on
going
scale
back to
and
the
on...
roots of what that word means. Like,
exactly.
Giant Greek monsters, titans, you know?
Yeah.
Totally. And there are plenty more in that game that are epic, but that is like by far my favorite in that game, a game of boss battles. Just that's pretty much what it is. And the final boss is really cool too. It's essentially it's one giant colossus, but it's like a tower kind of.
And like when you're approaching him, because it's like it's all just like these giant planes that you're running across to get to these guys for the most part. It's like when you finally see him like in the distance, like you're still really far away, and you just kind of go like, oh crap.
Yeah, like, he's like massive, and he like throws stuff at you like before you even get there. So it's like a challenge just to get to him, as opposed even like getting rid of the fact that like he's hard to fight on his own.
And it creates so much tension because like by the time you're like you get to him and you're climbing up to the top, you like by the time you're at the top, you're like, oh, don't get knocked off.
Oh my
like,
gosh, because it's so high and you'll just be dead and start. Yeah. You have to start over. So yeah, that's definitely one that's one that comes to mind. I think we were talking about Bayonetta earlier, but like anything that Platinum does is like pretty insane. Like. Mm-hmm. Metal Gear Rising or Vengeance has some like really killer boss battles. I think the very first boss in the game is Metal Gear Ray, and like Raiden like quite literally at one point like picks him up by the tail and like slams him and then like cuts him up, and like perfectly like in tune with like rockin' music, and like, oh man,
all I picture when you say rockin' music is just like like eyeball exploding guitar solos. Yeah, just like like in that one Weird Al music video where the guitar's playing the solo and just starts smoking and he explodes into tiny pieces,
basically.
Taylor, that's music. So you got two. You just threw two picks at us, did you?
Yeah.
So you got some Bayonetta with the Metal Gear Ray, and then Shadow of Colossus, a topic which we would be remiss in this discussion to not mention. So I'm glad you did first.
I just find it funny that he's fighting Metal Gear Ray. just as a boss battle. Yeah. And like, he picks it up and it's like throwing it around and everything like that. And it's like,
is that like a character in the other game?
Isn't it? Isn't that in two, the main, like one of the main Metal Gears?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure. Because the first one is Metal Gear Rex, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, I think Ray is Metal Gear 2.
Because that's like the amphibious one.
Yeah. And it's like huge, and you're like, how can I fight this one person? But then Raiden comes in and he's like, dead. all these swords. It's anime.
That was very articulate and eloquent.
Yep, it's true. I can't wait to listen to this without video.
Yeah.
It's going to be great. Exactly.
I want other people to talk, but I'm going to kick one off, and I think at least the three of us, and maybe Jake's playing this game, I don't know. One of my favorite battles in Final Fantasy Tactics is the last Gafgarian battle, where like Rams is separated from the group and you have to fight him on your own.
Yeah,
and
that's
then,
a
like,
classic.
And
that's
you have
classic.
To like open the gate and like get your guys in there, or like use auto potion or whatever. Like there's all different kinds of strategy to like.
If it wasn't so like boring, I would explain to you my exact strategy on how to win that fight every time and make Gafgarian your B-hatch. But yeah, that's a conversation for another time. But that's a classic one because they throw. That also reminds me of at the end of that very same, or the next chapter, when you have to fight Wigraf by yourself when you're Ramza.
Oh my god!
And he's
that
like,
so
and he's
annoying.
Just totally OP. He just kills you in like two turns, and then you kill him. And you're like, oh great, everything's perfect. And then he turns into this giant bull demon with four arms.
Yeah,
and
that summons Cyclops in two turns.
Yeah, summons three like Ultima demons, just like the nastiest critters you could ever find. And you're just like, oh, okay, well, this is going poorly now. which is actually a great segue, because that fight with Velius in Tactics is like one of the most awesome. Because like by the end, like when that fight starts, your blood is pumping. Like you're gripping the controller, your white knuckle, like it's a turn-based strat like RPG, and it still just gets
like
the blood
flowing. The music's like really intense.
Don't crit me.
Yeah. It's intense. It's so intense. The music is kind of creepy too, you know, like, oh man.
Look, you first walk into the room and he's just standing there alone with his back to you, just surrounded by corpses, and just like with the creepy music playing, and it's like, it's the atmosphere is perfect, and he's kind of like monologuing to you about like his evil intentions while you're fighting, and Rams is shooting back. It's like one of the best cinematic and gameplay and atmospheric moments in all of FFT, which is one of the best RPGs ever played. So that's a great nomination for awesome.
Easily the hardest battle in the game too, like without question.
No question.
Another hard battle is I think it's near the end of the game. It's with the three headed characters. No, what are they called? He's the guy with the gun. And she just snipes you from across the map.
There's that bridge with the behemoths.
Yeah, the behemoths.
Oh, man, I hate that.
That is a hard battle.
It's annoying. Yeah. If you don't have somebody with range, it's like, okay, what do I do?
Yeah, man, if I sucked at that game, that would be such a hard fight, dude. Wow, yeah.
I thought it was memorable.
Oh, dang.
I mean...
Shots fired.
I guess it's just... Like, these days, it's like, I never go into that, like, whole string of battles until I'm, like, totally beefed out, so that fight is always
like
easy.
Like, two Dark Knights and nine ninjas. And
well, that's even if you play with Dark Knights, but we're talking too much tactics.
Anyway.
Even though there's so many great boss fights in that game, but, dude, Jake, give us one of yours.
All right, so here's the thing. I don't want this to take a while, but I'm stuck on four different games. So I'm going to list them, and you tell me which ones you want to hear about.
You just talk about one right now, and then we'll talk about another ones, and then we'll go back to you.
Okay.
I cheated. Sorry, Jake.
That's okay.
You can talk about two if you want.
Okay, I might talk about two. Okay, so...
Halo, Destiny, and Rise.
No, the Halo boss fights were the worst. Like Tartarus? Fighting Tartarus was a joke. I hated
it. Just running around on that two-leveled structure.
Yeah, and you just like unload like three clips into him and he's done.
Yeah.
And it's just, you just don't go up. So he's this massive ape with a hammer. All you do is don't run up so that he can hit you with his hammer and shoot him with the ranged gun that you have. And then he dies.
So on to the good boss.
It's like, come on, Tartarus. You're so cool.
It's like you're just Indiana Jones and this guy runs out with a sword and he's swinging it around. And just swing, swing. Shoot him in the chest and keep going.
It's like the Fallout 3 ending.
So, all right. So I would say Cubivore is one of them. Cubivore is this super, what, do you know it?
No, I just know that you like that game a lot.
Yeah.
Is this from Titan Souls or what game is this from?
No, Cubivore is the game.
Oh, Cubivore is the game.
Yeah,
oh, okay.
It's for GameCube. And it it like no one's heard of this game, which sucks because it's fantastic and I would love a cube of war too. But the whole point of the game is that you start off the game. It's like imagine like you're a cube with a mouth and you're a pig. It's like a okay. like a Minecraft head, you know, where it's like a pig is like painted on it, right? So, but you're just a cube, and you kind of hop along, and you have a single square, not a cube, so like a flat plane attached to this cube, and that's your whole body. So you kind of just hop around awkwardly as a cube and a square attached to each other, and as you progress through the game and you beat these bosses, it's like you end up finding mates and having kids, and then the kids grow up and then they might have like two squares attached to them, and eventually let's say you have like four squares or something, you can have a back and like two legs, right? You know, and then maybe a tail or
sure
something. And it's weird, but it's like you kind of end up with more squares, you have more of a functional body rather than just this weird flopping head thing. And so
so to the boss fight,
yeah, well that's what I'm saying. So once you get to one of the final bosses, it's got like 9 or 10 squares attached to it, so it has like a mane, it has a body, it has like a long tail and two legs, and it's like it's awesome, and it's this super badass, really fast. It's like everything you are but just times 8 or something. It's just so powerful, so you have to be so on top of the game. And because of that, you know, in order to beat it, but because of that, when you beat it, it gives you just such this rush of accomplishment because it's just the game. There's no like gimmick. It's like if Mario beat Bowser in the first game without dropping him into lava, he just beat the crap out of Bowser. Like literally, he's just on top of him. Just
no cheapies.
Him. Yeah. It's like that would feel so good. But
yeah, it sounds like one of those fights where you get totally white knuckle, then right when you win, you just throw the controller at the ground and raise your fists above your head and start going, aah!
Right, like look at, you know, get David versus Goliath and take away David's slingshot and then still beat Goliath. Yeah, that's what it felt like. It
David
was awesome.
Has to just DDT Goliath.
Yeah, right?
Straight
it
on the ground.
It was just, oh my God, and it was
put
so
him in
fantastic.
A, put him in a, what's that? Sharpshooter. That submission
sharpshooter.
Hold.
Yeah.
Classic.
And I think that's kind of my criteria for a good boss battle too. I think it's less about the mechanics of the boss fight and more about the feeling after you beat them and how great it feels to have done it. And
exactly.
So oftentimes it equates to difficulty, right? Which is, you know, and that's another one, like Legend of Zelda, Wind Waker, that one especially, with at the end you have the whole duel with Ganondorf, and it's just so freaking cool because of the art style. He's got his two, like, not katanas, but like two swords. He's going at you like that, and then you've just got the, you know, the master sword, and it's just
especially when the odds are stacked completely against you.
Yeah, and
that's
kind of what
helps.
I like. It's just that, like, when you overcome this boss, it's not that you just beat it because you're on, like, you know, equal footing. It's no, it's the last boss because they're gonna kick your ass if you mess up at all.
Yeah, Nick, that reminds me of the final boss from Master of Arena, where like. And that's an Armored Core game, Armored Core Master of Arena. It's the last mission boss where usually everyone you fight in that game is like smaller than you or the same size as you. Because you're an AC, which is an Armored Core. Like you're a big robot. And so you're used to just fighting other ACs. And at the very end of the game, they throw like this giant mechanized like robot thing of death at you that's like 8 times bigger than you and like, shoots like 10 nukes at a time at you and has like 8 billion, you know, heavy assault machine guns, just like right when the fight starts, just starts raining death on you. And it's like one of those boss fights where you just have to like die 30 times until you get lucky and beat them that one time.
Yep.
But when you do, it's a controller. It's a controller thrower for sure. You just throw it at the nearest living thing and go, yeah!
That's one of my picks as well as Armored Core 4 Answer. It wasn't the final boss, but it was just like, I think it was you and you had like 2 allies or something like that. And then there were like 6 enemies that came at you and they were all super strong. So it's just you had to build an AC just for this boss fight. And it's like you had to optimize like crazy. I mean, it was just, but when you beat it, it's just such a
boss.
Phenomenal.
You're the boss.
Yeah, you are. Yeah.
You're the king.
Your teammates are dead because they suck. And so you're taking all of them out.
So Jake, if that's the kind of boss fight you like, I got the perfect game for you.
What's up?
It's from a developer called From Software, creators of Armored Core. It's called Bloodborne.
Yeah. I was thinking about that as well.
I forgot. Did you buy Bloodborne when it came out?
I ended up having to sell it. Because again, I a little tight on money
life
at the time.
Life happened.
But yeah. So I ended up beating a couple of the bosses. And yeah, it just felt awesome to beat. Yeah, totally. It was just fantastic.
That is what that is the key to that game. It's like these guys are going to kick your ass, but you feel like $1 million
but
when you finally beat them.
Even then, even as hard as that was to beat those bosses, it wasn't. I think the difficulty with that game lies more in the entire grind, the whole process, not just the boss fights.
Oh, the just normal because, enemies can be hard.
Yeah. and I, that's what I'm saying is because I think that, like, for instance, the Cubivore fight and Titan Souls, which is my last pick, those are more difficult boss fights than in Dark Souls and Bloodborne. Because I think Bloodborne, everything is kind of set up for you to beat it. It's just, it's like you just can't mess up as you do it, you know, and that's the big thing.
But that's all of Titan, that's all Titan Souls.
Well, yeah. Okay. No, that's a good point. I don't know why then Titan Souls gave me such more of a rush.
Well, there are no trash mobs or whatever you want to call them, like the in-between enemies. It's just boss
in
battles,
Titan
right?
Souls, yeah.
Yeah.
It's like one hit, one kill for both. So.
Yeah, exactly. That is actually the other cool thing I like about
high
Titan Souls.
Tension.
That it's just if you hit the boss once, it dies, and if it hits you once, you die. And so, but it's just difficult because it's like, well, because like sometimes you have to hit it multiple times to expose the weak point, which is then the one hit kill. So, you know, but
the whole process, but still.
But man, yeah. It's great.
Okay, so guys,
yeah,
I want to hear one of yours, but real quick, I'm not going to discuss. I'm just going to throw them out there, and you can just go, yes, okay. Or no.
So thumbs up, thumbs down type.
Yeah.
Thing.
So
okay.
This one, I think most of you guys have played Resident Evil 4, the giant plant monster, where it takes up the entire room, and there's three levels, and like, oh Jesus, that fight is insane.
I don't remember that.
It's Salazar.
Yeah,
turns
Mr. Kennedy.
Yeah, it's him. He turns into
And like there's like a big flower at the top, and he's like in it, like his little mummified, you know, dead body, like. Keep shooting it, like, and to open it up, and then hit him with the rocket launcher.
Okay, yeah, I remember that.
And like all the while, you're scrambling up these like three levels that are on the opposite wall, and like these big, you know, plant vines are coming swiping and like picking you up and throwing you and stuff.
I think that was more annoying than the final boss.
Yeah, no, it totally was. And that fight just took so long.
Yeah.
So there's that, and there's Lich King from World of Warcraft, of course, classic at the time. Not really so much now.
World of Warcraft, dang! There's so many good boss battles, and wow.
Yeah, and the final Deathwing fight in Cataclysm was awesome too, where he's flying through the air and you're fighting on his back, which is completely like idiotic, but totally freaking sweet.
Oh yeah, I'm sure. It feels like amazing when you're doing it.
Well, yeah, like Maddie's off screen. She's just like,
she's looking at me like. My homie.
I know.
Yeah, exactly. And I had one other good one. Oh, darn it. I totally lost it. So,
well, yeah, Nick, why don't you
William
Birkin. One?
Right. First,
he's not much of a boss actually, fight, but you just pump him full of bullets and he dies.
Or just Tyrant from the B games of Resident Evil 2.
I remember, like you said, talking about Master of Arena. I was like, and that reminded me of the AC2 final boss. Where you're just, it's like this really like epic music, and you're just going down this elevator.
Oh yeah,
and he's just monologuing to you.
Yeah,
and then you get at the end, and it's just like really tall.
Yeah, he's like 8 stories tall. Yeah, and you're just like, oh great, this is a fair fight.
Yeah. When you beat him, you're like, yeah. You're
like, that guy is like 64 of me, and I'm like a giant 3 story tall like robot of death.
Yeah,
and he's just like 128 of those.
I remember we had to cheese him. I remember like one time we were I was over at your house. It was like at midnight or something, and you were playing your file, and you like totally cheesed it with like machine gun arms and everything. Like
yeah.
And once you beat it, you threw the controller down and everything like that. And you're
like,
and
I said,
away.
Touchdown.
I've been known to spike a controller too at times of great triumph or sorrow. So don't let me use your controller.
It was good. One of my favorite boss battles. I mean, this is not even a surprise. Is a. In the Tales of Destiny remake, you actually fight.
Wait, is this the remake specifically?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah. This is a specific boss battle for the remake. You fight Dimlos.
Oh, so you fight the sword. Interesting.
So you know the story.
Yeah, I know the story.
So you know when you upgrade your Swordian at the end of the game.
Yeah.
To make it more powerful to fight the super Swordian.
Yeah.
To
do that, you have to fight Dimlos.
Yeah,
in the
so
remake.
You're supposed to fight Dimlos, and it's like the cool because it's only Stan and Dimlos, and it's like a fighting game, and it's just super awesome because you have to like counter him and then do all this crazy ass stuff.
Huh?
For sure.
Yeah. Cool. And cool. That, yeah, so and the music.
I wish
really
I'd played
epic.
It. I wish I'd played it.
I'll show you it. It's really
dude.
Cool.
Music is so huge in boss fights.
It is.
Yeah. So
it's like, because all I have to say is One Winged Angel. Yeah. That is
dude.
Yeah, it's
Sephiroth.
It like, makes that it's fight just yeah. like infinitely more insane.
It's exactly like in the Dimlos fight because the music's all epic and he's like monologuing. He's like, "You are too weak for me to," you know. It's all in Japanese.
Well,
so
Dimlos
sounds,
is always talking smack to Stan.
Yeah,
that's the best part.
So it's all in Japanese. He's like talking smack to you, and yeah, and then you fight him and kick his ass, and it's great.
Yeah, I'll have to check that out. Okay, so I remember my other one, but it's not so much like specific boss fights. I just wanted to bring up two games that, like, just as a rule, have really legendary boss fights almost all the time.
I think I know what one of them is.
Give me your guess, dude.
Something Mega Man.
No, but I feel like that's a given. It's like every boss fight in Mega Man is fun.
Yeah.
But I was going to say Ni No Kuni.
Ah.
Ni No Kuni boss fights are really fun because you're controlling all three guys and they're throwing like the big spells where you have to all out defend.
Right.
And like you really just like it's...
You
it's,
have to pay attention.
Yeah, yeah. You have to pay really close attention. It's a white knuckle ride. And sometimes like you'll get down to your last guy with like 10 health and then you pull out this crazy like inexplicable victory.
It was always those guys that had those little poison balls that were always all over the place.
Yeah.
Those were always tough because you had to avoid them.
The nightmares?
Yeah.
And that and Lunar 1 and 2 both Lunar. Are just like, because those are the boss fights that are like, they're not like so much really intense action. They're just like chess matches.
Exactly. And yeah, like, it's like, when do I use my spell or when do I use my epic special
exactly.
attack?
And
yeah.
It's all about like conservation. Some of them are like total wars of attrition where you're like out of mana and like you're just down to the wire and you win with one guy left with 10 health. And
those were
like,
the signs of good like design in classic JRPGs where it was that like, okay, I feel like how I'm going to save all my mega potions or whatever.
Yeah,
you know?
If I use all my MP at the beginning, then I won't have it later for, you know, XYZ.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I felt like Persona did that pretty well too. Like there were fights where like I just barely had enough. I like that. Like when you feel like it's an actual struggle, not just like, oh, I grinded my way and
right.
I just kicked their butt. Like
exactly.
Feels that much more satisfying.
So I forgot, guys. There's two more.
Okay.
Yeah,
totally forgot. So one, Asura's Wrath. I bring it up occasionally because I just love that game to no end. It's absolutely one of my favorite games of all time, and the whole game is so epic. It's just kind of like Shadow of the Colossus. How you were saying, it's just epic, right? It's like the kind of thing where, and this was in the demo too. But you know, the dude, one of the guys you're fighting, his name's Wizen, and he pretty much makes himself, because you challenge him, right? He makes himself larger than the planet, than Earth, right? And he's sitting there.
Seems legit.
Yeah, so he's like floating next to Earth, and he's sitting there, and he's kind of doing his like his meditation thing, and then he's just kind of, as he's talking to you, he brings his finger down, and it's just, you know, the finger is going down onto the planet, and it's starting, there's like fire all around the finger, because it's entering orbit and all that, and it's coming down just right onto you, and so you're literally watching this finger pretty much block out the tip of his finger blocking out the entire sky, and then you know you're standing there and you're like, oh my god, and then you just sprout two extra arms, so you have four arms now, and you just open your arms up just like, bring it, and you just have to like stop it, and you know, so then you're like you're stomping the X button and you're like, come on,
it's like the classic like being caught in the dinosaur's
yeah,
mouth
exactly,
and you gotta push
and,
it open.
And it's just like, that's the first boss, and it's every boss, believe me, every boss is more epic than the last. It's just so, oh my god,
it
guys.
Sounds like how you
it's
describe
so
Bayonetta.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like where it just keeps getting crazier and crazier, and you don't
it
think it can
crazier.
And then it keeps getting crazy
by the end of the game. It is just hilarious. It's like the end of the game, I could equate it to me writing down a super badass character, right? And being like, man, I don't think anything can ever beat this. And then I show it to you, Connor, right? And then you look at it and it's like, oh, I know of one way to beat this guy. And I'm like, there's no way to beat him. And you're like, yeah. And you rip the paper where it's like so meta, where it's like you literally rip the paper. The character's gone. And I'm like, dude, that doesn't count. You're but like, it gets
it
so meta, right? And then that's like the paper then punching and beating the crap out of you after you
and
do
then
that.
You have to figure out what to do
exactly.
about that.
And it's not, it just, it escalates to ridiculous levels like that.
My mind is
floating
up here. It's like when you're playing that game, the final boss, the only way to beat him is just pick up your PS4 and like smash it on the ground repeatedly.
And it's like literally, it's that kind of meta where it's just like, it gets so funny. So there was Osra's Wrath, and then the last one was actually Skolas, the most recent boss that I've fought in a game. So Skolas, the last boss in Destiny.
Oh yeah, the one House we talked about last week off of camera, I believe.
Yeah. That's the one. So in House of Wolves, the second DLC for Destiny, which Taken King is not tomorrow. Oh my god,
Wows of Wolves.
So excited. Yes, the Wows of Wolves.
Nice.
But he's the final boss in it, and what I absolutely love about it is that he just takes so much. He gives so much damage, and he takes so much damage. So he's just, it's a long, long
fire,
fight.
Just a straight up barn burn.
Right. So like the actual length of the fight, like of your successful run of the fight, you know, still may take up to an hour. Just to kill this one dude, and it's with three people, because you can't do it with one, you can't do it with two. It's three people against him, and you have to have crazy good teamwork.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I love about it, because like at one point, let's say it's, you know, like me, Nick, and Taylor, right? He'll infect one of us with a disease or something, which will kill us in 30 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
But one of us, like, let's say I'm infected, Nick can take the disease from me, and that means that I'm then immune for, like, 45 seconds from the disease.
Oh, wow.
Okay.
So then I have 45 seconds of immunity. Nick has 30 seconds before he dies.
Oh, that's,
and then,
like,
so
sounds
Taylor
like WoW
has
mechanics.
To take
just
it.
To keep passing it around.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, wow.
And so, but then, like, let's say, you know, we're going, right? And then... Taylor, you die, for instance, and you're going to be up in 30 seconds, and you've got 15 seconds to live, and I've got still 30 seconds of immunity. I can't
just
take
around
it.
Like,
yeah,
what?
That's what I'm saying. I can't take it from you anymore. He can't take it from you because he's dead. And so then you're pretty much just going to die.
You res him. So you almost have to plan out ahead of time. It's like, I'm going to get it first, then you. Like, you'll have to have like a turn order.
And that's the thing is that it gets so stressful and crazy sometimes, because then Nick would die, and then I would still have to wait until you're up. So then I would revive Taylor. Just so that whoever,
that
whichever one of us,
intense.
So cool. That's the entire boss fight, and that's just one of the mechanics in it.
I can't remember what boss it was, but it was like one of the first couple boss fights when we did the first raid in Destiny. It was pretty intense like that. Like, you had to, there was something you had to pass around like that. There was a guy, he kept having a shield up or something like that, and like...
Oh, yeah, we're talking about the something in the Vault of Glass. What's his name?
I don't even know if it's the Vault of Glass.
You said the first
bad
raid?
Guy.
Is it the first raid?
Yeah, the Vault of Glass, raid, and it was the big floating dude with the shield that, like, someone had to go around with a relic until they could hit him with the relic, and then his shield would go down, and everyone could hit him for, like, a few seconds before his shield came back up.
Yeah. I don't mean to go down on this Destiny rabbit hole, but I want to, though, is the thing.
Yeah.
But what I liked about the raids were, I've never played an FPS game that asked you to do those type of mechanics. Mm-hmm. It was totally, it's like, imagine WoW mechanics, but in an FPS. That's like what it was.
And with only six people, like, it meant that
everybody had to pull their weight.
Yeah, exactly. Like, if
and
one person dies.
Unfortunately, I'm not
going to
name names, but in our raid, there were a couple people that didn't pull their weight.
Yeah.
We have some leechers and some fire standers. Those fire standers are the worst. They just can't get out of the flames, man.
Oh my gosh, yeah. It's like, don't stand in the fiery stuff. That's the typical WoW.
Excuse me, sir. I believe that you're dying. I think your life is slipping away right now, sir.
Don't stand the green stuff.
But yeah, it was just that's kind of what I love it. And I love it strictly because of how much teamwork it needed from people. Like, you couldn't do it without teamwork. It's not like you can just get powerful enough to do it on your own. No, you need a team. It's great.
Marvelous.
I'm done. I've talked a lot.
Does anybody want to throw out any more before we move on?
I'll throw out just a couple memorable ones, but you go first, Nick.
Who's played Unreal Tournament?
Well, you know the answer to that, Mr. Nicholas.
Who's beat Unreal Tournament?
That would be me, sir. Well, that also depends which
Unreal
one
Tournament
we're
talking. Unreal Tournament 99.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, so you remember Xan?
Yes.
Remember that battle?
I mean, I've played Unreal Tournament 99 lately, but not beaten it. Like, that, we're talking like 2002 that.
Yeah. I remember playing... Unreal Tournament's campaign mode is an actual tournament.
Yeah, it's awesome.
And the final...
There's brackets
and everything.
Oh, interesting.
And then the final battle is with this character named Xan. You've heard about him like throughout the entire like story and stuff like that. And he's like the champion.
He's the biggest, baddest. Of course.
He's a robot made for this specific sport. And the entire...
Not fair.
Yeah,
it's
isn't
not
it?
Very fair.
Exactly. It's corrupt.
Yeah.
But so you're fighting him, and he's all this taunting you. He's like, I am the Alpha and the Omega. And it's like, you know, destroying you.
That's literally the voice he has, too.
Yeah.
prepare or die, human being.
Yep. And he's just destroying you, and you know it. Oh, just like the difficulty just went like, bam, this strut straight up. Mm-hmm. And once you beat him, you have to beat him with like this rockets, this straight up cheese.
Only way.
Yeah. And once you do it, you're like, I'm done.
Yeah.
I'd accomplished something that. That's a lot another, of people can't.
That's I another white knuckler. Today.
Yeah. It's another white knuckler where, except you know what the catch is? There's no controller to spike with when you're playing Unreal Tournament.
No, so but there's a table to hit.
Yeah, the only thing to do is pick up your keyboard and slap it against your monitor repeatedly as if you're a baseball player trying to hit a home run.
The only thing you can do.
Only yeah. thing. It's just I mean, so much hype.
There's no music. Options. I know. It's scary stuff, but.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I just remember, like, it's like, you're 14, the kill limit's 15. You're at 14 kills, and he's at 8 kills, and then suddenly he's on a killing spree, and he's at 14 kills, and you're at 14 kills, and you're, oh God, kill him, kill him, kill him, yeah!
Oh my, Jesus.
I think you actually just had, like, a flashback. Like, yep. Like some
Nick, it's okay, it's okay. The year is 2015. You're yeah. okay, you're here.
Yeah,
oh no, like, you're on our friends. Podcast, there's buddy. Another Unreal tournament I gotta beat.
No!
He's having a flashback like some like 65-year-old dude who used to fall around the Grateful Dead. It's like, oh, geez, I think I see him again, man. Jack, that's just the acid that's still lingering in your brain.
So you had one, Connor?
Shoot.
I'm going to throw a couple out there while you pontificate.
Yeah,
you
let's just throw yours out. Let's call it a day.
I think, you know, obviously, like one game that I think has a lot of memorable boss fights is Final Fantasy VII. And maybe
that doesn't have any memorable boss fights.
None. But I can remember the first boss fight that like consistently like would kick my butt was Carry Armor.
Yeah.
I felt like that was the first really hard fight in that game.
Until you realized
Carry Armor, how heavy was it?
Real heavy.
No, but what he would do is he would like, so he had like two arms and then he had like a core. And what he would do is every once in a while he would like pick up one of your members and like, I think, right? He would pick yeah, up a
he,
party
he
member.
He would just hold them and they're totally immobilized. You can't use them.
And, but the thing was, if you attacked him, it would also hurt your party yeah. members a little bit, I think.
Yeah. Oh, that's awesome.
So I think the strategy, he couldn't grow his arms back, right? Like the strategy was to kill his arms.
Yeah.
And then the other one that was memorable for also being hard and kind of, it kind of handicapped you if you didn't use this character was Demon Gate, Demon's Gate. Because you had to use Eris, and like most people didn't use Eris.
Right, so she like, totally
okay, well,
stunk.
Yeah.
She had like no physical attack power, no health.
And like at least she had Healing Wind, like that's all she was good for.
Yeah, exactly. Especially in that fight when like she's getting hit so hard that she's getting her limit break like every other turn.
Yeah, seriously.
It's like the only thing keeping you in it is that you're just Healing Winding every single 5 seconds you get free.
Well, I could just remember like sitting there and Demon's Gate like drops those rocks on you. It's like dead, dead,
yeah,
dead.
Like, and he's slowly scooting up towards you closer. And by the time he's like 5 feet in front of your face, you're like, I think this is like not good. Yeah. And then he uses Demon Rush and everyone gets obliterated.
And like really nothing was, he was not really weak to anything.
Yeah,
like,
he,
Bahamut,
was, well, he was extremely resistant against all kinds of elemental magic. And physical attack. So the only thing he was weak against was element or non-elemental magic, which at that point, the only thing you have is Bahamut.
Yeah.
So you use Bahamut once and then...
Let there be light.
Let there be light, indeed. So, but yeah, that was a classic. And that was like your rite of passage to becoming an FF7 like badass. Because at that point, you had to do a lot of work to get there. But like that's the first battle that really like makes you push it completely to the edge where like you win the fight and... Two of your three guys are dead, and the last guy alive has, like, no MP and, like, 10 health.
Yeah,
and, like,
exactly.
You're just, like, screaming, yes!
Exactly.
Do you remember the boss fight, the beginning of Tales, or, like, beginning of Tales of Destiny? You fight Leon for the first time, and you can't win?
Oh, yeah.
Do you remember winning that?
Oh, yeah. We used Game Shark to kick to kick his butt one time.
Yeah. And they have a scene afterwards where it's like, Rudy's like, yeah, we're the strongest in the world. Let's take over the world. And it says, they take over the world. And it just ends.
The game's over?
Yeah, the game ends. So
wait,
they made a,
so
they made
actually,
a
awesome. You can actually win the game.
They
like,
made
right
a specific scenario for the case if you cheat to beat Leon right there, because you're supposed to lose. He does like thousands of damage. You have like 100 health at that time.
Okay.
So like you just die instantly, like if you don't cheat. But we use Game Shark and you know, we kick his butt and then it just says, yep, they took over the world. Game's over. And it's like right at the very beginning too.
It's hilarious.
So it's basically that whole sequence is just to troll anyone who tries to cheat past that part.
Yeah. That's funny. Reminds me of Far Cry 4 at the beginning of the game where it's like, just wait right here.
Yeah.
And then if you do wait, the game's over.
Yep.
But anyway.
So good.
Boss battles, huh? That was an awesome discussion.
Yeah, leave a comment. Tell us some great boss battles, because there's countless that we're missing. Like a couple I forgot to mention. Psycho Mantis from MGS1.
Oh, the classic awesome boss battle.
Yeah. MGS3. Yeah. Every single fight in MGS3. Awesome stuff. So
yeah, let us know. Give us your passionate stories, your white knuckle moments against bosses.
I feel like, you know what was funny? As going into this conversation, I thought this was going to be the short one. The next one was going to be longer. Like, we have a huge topic coming up.
For sure.
I don't know how we're going to like fit this.
You know, we forgot a whole series of boss battles. The Isuga series.
East has some good ones. Some good boss battles. They're like intense.
We've got time for the next topic.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Can we pause for a moment, guys?
So,
we're back.
Yay!
I think that was a good cutting off point anyway.
Yeah.
So shall we move on to our final topic?
This is going to be just as long as that one.
This might be a long podcast.
I just realized
podcast.
We were talking, and then all of a sudden, for them, we just said, we're back.
Well, there will be a cut, I'm sure.
Well,
I'll add an explosion,
anyway,
all right?
We left for a little bit. Sorry, guys.
Yeah. Our next topic. Connor, can you word this properly for us?
Yeah, of course. This is a topic that any person who is an avid gamer will have a myriad of opinions and angles about. What are the games that formed and defined you as a young gamer, making you the gamer that you are today?
Cubivore.
Cubivore? All right, that's the second name drop right there.
Pretty much it.
Okay.
It's pretty much it.
Let me pick up the names that were dropped. who wants to go first? Because, I mean, this isn't one of those things you really have to even think about. It's just like, oh, that was my favorite game when I just went up.
Exactly.
Or like,
I think I know both of yours.
He raised his hand first.
I know. I was just gonna say
Cubivore.
I'm pretty sure. I'm pretty sure you know mine.
Okay.
And let's start with Jake.
And I'm pretty sure I know Jake's.
Well, let's start with Jake.
Yeah. No. How about let's make this a game. Let's try to guess each other's.
All right.
You have to pick one number one one.
Oh, we have to pick one number one.
Pick a number one draft pick among most influential games.
You've seen my list, guys.
We haven't read.
No, I just mean that you've seen how big it is. I don't know if I can pick just one. All right. I'll try and pick one. Wait, what age are we going for? Like, are we talking?
Because when you would consider, like, okay, this stopped being like a fun, like, when you really feel like you got into it, or like it I don't know.
Your
like,
childhood wonderment.
The most significance to you.
Because I'm trying to think, like, okay. Yeah, because, so Super Mario Sunshine was awesome, but I'm thinking that was too late. I was already, like, way into it by then.
Yeah.
So I think I'm going to go, all right, I'll go.
I'd say earlier is better. Like, I'd say around, like, like first, second gen.
Oh man!
You know what? I think Fallout New Vegas.
Okay, somebody, one of you guys, Bold Jake is thinking. Guess mine. I've picked one.
You've picked one, so I would say either Final Fantasy VII or Resident Evil 2. No,
I would say Diablo 2.
Oh, dude! Now I have to rethink everything. Oh man, you destroyed me. Oh, and I totally forgot one of my favorite boss experiences ever.
You can't just pick one.
I know, dude. Well, now that everything, I was gonna say Final Fantasy Tactics because that like totally indoctrinated me to the lifestyle of strategy RPGs.
Yeah, that's good.
And just like made me love abilities and assigning and leveling and acquiring.
Well, it was so much deeper than like anything we had played. Because
I know it was totally unheard of at the time. The depth of customization of characters.
Well, because I feel like for the most part, we only bought it because it was a Final Fantasy game, not because it was a strategy game. At least that's why I bought it.
Well, I played it because you and Dallas, my older brother, were
right,
playing.
Yeah. I played it because Brian had it.
Yeah,
exactly.
I didn't play it.
Yeah, Well, sorry. but that's
now
fine.
Look at you.
Final Fantasy Tactics. That's I would say one of my most influential games.
How many times would you say you've beaten it? Or have you lost track at this point?
Probably 7 or 8 times.
Okay. It's a good number.
Yeah. I'm just kidding, by the way. I did play Final Fantasy Tactics Advance, which
it's close enough to get the idea.
It's the same gameplay, but
I played that when I was young on the Game Boy
Advance.
Ramza
and those
different
guys.
Format.
Yeah, it's a different format.
Ramza. Yeah, it's still
in the first
Tactics
one.
Advance?
In the first one, yeah. Tactics Advance 2, it's Lusso.
Oh, okay. Okay. I didn't know that.
I don't think it's Ramza. I think it's like...
No, it's Ramza.
March.
Oh, yeah, it's March. Yeah, he looks exactly like Ramza, but his name's March.
Yeah.
What kind of name is March?
I don't know. They're like kids.
God damn it. Yeah, but
you can't be New Kid forever. I saw that one picture that's going around. Sorry, just quick little tangent where they have the snowball fight. And it's like, hey, New Kid, and it's like, hey, what's your name anyway? You can't just be New Kid forever. And someone, some cheeky bastard, named their character New Kid.
This is from South Park.
No,
this is Tactics Advance.
It was just a screenshot of someone like of the you can't be New Kid forever. And then someone typing in New Kid, and it was like,
Taylor, that was the episode of South Park where they tackled the hot cultural topic of Final Fantasy Tactics Advance.
But he meant South Park, the Stick of Truth, because you play as the new kid in the game.
You dumb son of a bitch.
You jerk, Connor.
And you failed.
Taylor, most formative game, Final Fantasy VII?
Duh.
That's a given. That's a given. Is that the one you picked, though?
Yeah, of course. Okay. Yeah, I mean...
Give us a few words.
I mean, up until that point, I was mostly like into like the platformy sports. I played a lot of sports games.
Crash Bandicoot.
Yeah, Crash Bandicoot, like Game Day football, Madden football type
Mega
stuff. Mega Man, totally.
Is it Skater?
Yeah, it was like Skater or Thrasher, like the skateboard games.
Well, there was Skate, and then there was
Skate or Die.
And then there was Thrasher. Thrasher was tight, had the ragdoll physics.
Yeah, it was pretty funny. But our buddy Josh, I think he was really the... I blame him or like whatever you want to call it for like getting all of us into those types of games, because he was like, dude, Final Fantasy VII is going to be amazing. I'm like, this game's stupid. You got like block hands. Like, what are we even doing here? And then he like let me borrow it. I'm like, oh my God, like what is this game? Like, I didn't know games could be this. Like, walk around and have a story with characters you cared about, you know?
My new, like, number one wish, if I ever got a genie, is introduce Taylor to young Taylor pre-Final Fantasy VII just to watch you go off on this kid. It's like, how do you think this is not going to be a great game?
How do you even start?
This game is going to change your life, literally.
I can just picture current you just, like, saying to, like, young you, like, sit down.
Yeah. Tell you a little story.
Why don't you take a seat there, buddy?
Yeah.
Listen.
I watch Dateline.
You ever seen a grown man naked? Do you like gladiator movies, son?
I'm going to give you a little glimpse of your future here.
I don't even know what's happening anymore. I would say, though... To try to reel us in here.
Yeah, bring us back.
I would say at a very close second, actually not very close, but definitely a second would be Resident Evil 2.
Of course.
Because like JRPGs are my favorite, but I love like atmospheric survival horror games, and like Resident Evil 2, like we destroyed that game as kids, you know? Like we beat that game up, right, left, down, mm-hmm. like every which way.
That was like Capcom just punching my brain in the face when Resident Evil 2 came out. Just like, take this, like, you young man who is like still forming like the basis of his personality. Like, just take this. And everything has been a consistent downward gradient since then.
Punched you in the face and you crapped yourself.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I literally pissed myself the story I told 2 weeks ago, but that's another tale. So, Nick, your most formative, influential game... MechWarrior 2 Mercenaries?
You got it.
Nice.
Did I even get the number in the...
You got MechWarrior 2 right.
Okay, for sure. MechWarrior 2.
Mercenaries was a little bit afterwards.
Yeah, it was Mercenaries 2, but I think like that was after the original... That was just an aftershock of the original, earth-shattering quake.
So was
quake.
It Ghost Bear or whatever?
No, it was just called original? MechWarrior 2.
Okay, so it was Jade Falcon against
and
the...
Ghost Wolf.
And Clan Wolf
Smoke Bear. I'm thinking Smokey the Bear.
Okay, so it was Clan Wolf versus Jade Falcon. That was the first one, and then they had an expansion called Ghost Bear's Legacy, mm-hmm. which is you played as Ghost Bear
and Smoke Jaguars was the other
Smoke
one.
Smoke Jaguar
right?
was another one.
Okay,
yes.
for sure.
And then
Smoke Bear.
And there was the green monkeys and the silver snakes and the purple parrots and.
Yeah, there was
So I didn't
the
think
adventurous
you were,
platypi.
Taylor, I didn't know that you were joking right there because that all sounded pretty legit. Like, so for all of this other stuff, I'm just like, okay. And then Taylor's like in the solar snakes, and I'm like, yeah. Like,
Jake is just over there like, this game sounds retarded. Jesus. Who thought of this direct?
Okay, again, the purple parrot. That's not very intimidating, but okay.
Oh, God.
And then after Ghost Bear, it went to the other side, which is the Inner Sphere, and you played as Mercenaries.
Mercenaries, I feel like, was maybe the best of the bunch.
Oh, yeah, Mercenaries is amazing.
You can take the parts and you can make your own guys. And
but, okay, let's go back to where MechWarrior 2 came into my life. So,
yeah, please.
So I was
you know, 5 years old. I was playing games like Jumpman, Captain Bible, and Commander Keen.
Oh, love Captain Bible, dude. Oh, so good.
And those are all DOS games, and then suddenly, bam, 3D robots just blowing the crap out of
giant
each other.
Giant freaking robots with giant freaking guns.
Exactly. And I got addicted to this game. It was in my mind 24/7. I played it at recess. I played it at home.
When we were outside of recess, we would be going, yep. Target acquired.
Emily neck destroyed.
Yeah, exactly.
I was watching some old family videos, and every time you see me at that age, I'll be just going, Emily mech destroyed. Emily mech destroyed.
Emily?
Yeah, he said it backwards.
You could see his dad in the background of all those shots, just like with his head buried in his hands. What have I done?
And yeah, so game.
Where did I steer
so
wrong?
Influential. It was a great game, awesome. Though. I mean, you just customized your mech, did simple objectives, and blowed stuff up. Blew stuff up. I was in 6 year old mode right there.
Got caught. Finding some dwarfs.
Some dwarfs.
No, dwarfs?
It was dwarfs. There's no W.
Dwarfs?
Yeah,
dwarfs.
That's what Nick would call them.
You're a dwarf. You.
I'm just picturing a really squat, like, Ganondorf now. Like, really, really, like, with a pickaxe, you know? Yeah.
Hey, Connor, can I read your white dwarf?
Yeah, exactly. When I think dwarf, I just picture a guy who looks like he had his face caved in by getting kicked in the face by a donkey, you know? His eyes are all far apart, and they're looking in different directions.
Hey, do you see that guy over there? What, that dwarf?
Yeah. Yeah, man, I couldn't tell if he was looking at me or trying to find his car in the parking lot.
Oh, man.
Oh, man. But yeah,
he could stand on the front porch and count the chickens in the backyard. Yeah, my God. Anyways, so we've been, without any modicum of structure whatsoever, we've been discussing games that were significant to us when we were young.
Yeah, okay. MechWarrior 2 freaking changed me. Yeah. I mean, it was so addicting. And then the next game after that, which pretty much like took over my life, I bet you guys know.
Unreal or Tales?
Tales.
Okay.
Yeah.
Tales of Destiny.
So, okay, I think you've told me this before, but what was it about Tales that stood out as opposed to like Final Fantasy or whatever these other RPGs that we were playing at the time?
Actually, I'm curious too, because like you did a lot of sports. Like you got into sports when you were younger, right? And then, you know, then you got into giant freaking robots with giant freaking guns. Then how did you go from that to something that most people who haven't experienced it before would consider extremely Japanese and nerdy and like not
well,
very
that
cool
point,
and fun.
Okay, obviously, so nerdiness point, is not yeah, a thing
the
that exists. Yeah,
blurred, like we didn't know any better.
So,
yeah, exactly.
These guys had Final Fantasy VII. I did not. One of my brother's birthdays, Taylor got him Tales of Destiny.
Oh, really? I did? Oh, okay. Well,
and
well, go me.
It's your fault, dude.
Sorry.
And he started, like, I watch my brother play it all the time. And
I like
then,
how it's sorry instead of you're welcome.
my bad on that, dude.
My brother, like, played it and I watched him. And then he got a channeling ring and I started playing it with him. And then he allowed me to play it. And that's where I got my first RPG experience.
Nice.
And I started playing it and bringing it over to Connor's house and Travis's house. And
where we would build Legos into the night while... Because they had the player... Like, they had the sound editor, like, you could access on the...
That's right.
The main menu, so which lets you just, like, play all the songs from the game that you'd heard up to that point. And so we would just blast Tales of Destiny music all night while we built Legos.
That's
made
awesome.
Stop motion...
That's just
videos.
Such an awesome memory. That's really cool.
Yeah, it's
cool.
Awesome.
I'm jealous of that one.
And I got Connor bought it, Travis bought it, and everyone had it, and we just played it all.
Remember, all three of us, we were all fighting to see who could get the last hidden art first, Phoenix?
Yeah.
Because you had to get to level 50, you had to get the giant disc from Tower of Duraga, and then, like, there's these three things you had to fulfill to do it, or two. And I remember, you, like, got to level 50, but didn't get the disc, and like Travis like got the disc and wasn't level 50, and I was the son of a gun that did first both. And I remember showing up to school all stoked one day, just being like, yo, check it out. They're like, I don't know how I like proved it to you guys.
No,
you had to like come over and see
it. Your Kodak camera and went and got it developed.
Went over to his house and he was
like, I took it into the dark room and
we went over to his house and he's like, check this out. We go into a random battle, presses the button, Stan gets all big and flies
the protagonist,
by as a
protagonist grows like 10 times the size and then torches everything on the screen.
And we're like, holy crap.
I'm like, yep, that's right, guys. I'm better than you, pretty much.
I wonder why you're the one who remembers that.
I'm a more memorable human being than you guys will ever be.
It was Tales of Destiny and then Tactics. So.
Yeah, that came awesome. After. Because Tactics was a little harder to understand.
Yeah, it's kind of amazing. That came out in like 97?
And I don't know if this is something I've mentioned on the podcast before. There was a magical like year and a half by Squaresoft where they came out with Final Fantasy VII and then Final Fantasy Tactics and then Xenogears in the span of like a year. And that's like three of the best 10 RPGs like that have ever existed. In my opinion.
Oh, totally. Dude, Square was just churning out gold after gold. God, it's like, how could you possibly do that? Like, over and over and over again.
They were
it was
full,
insane.
They were full NBA Jam. They were on fire, dude. They were shooting three-pointers from under the basket on the other side of the court and swishing them.
Right when they released a game. Boom, shakalaka! Yeah,
exactly. Seriously. From downtown! Oh, he's
like,
on fire!
I could probably, like, maybe count on one hand, like, bad RPGs that they released on the PS1 and then, like...
Once you get to PS2, all bets are off.
Yeah, yeah.
But, like, on PS1... PS3, it's just not yeah,
even... There's, like, it. One, maybe. I can count on one hand the good ones.
Yeah, seriously.
Oh,
but
man.
Anyway,
so we've all got some good ones in.
We need Jake.
Yeah. Let's get some more.
Well, so, did you guys even want to guess, or? I mean, well, it's just so far removed from what you guys experienced.
Well, give us a system. At least tell 64. Us the system. 64. Okay. I wouldn't have guessed that, but
Kazooie.
I would.
Yeah, that's one of them. I mean, that's. I wouldn't know.
Well, that's like one on the list of like 85.
Well, there's no, it's not the whole list, but like that's okay. Definitely. That's really up there. That was Banjo-Kazooie was fantastic. Wasn't as much formative. GoldenEye. Okay. Mario 64 was my first. So I guess that was the first video game I owned. So I guess that is pretty good. Except, when I was younger, I played like Putt-Putt and things like that on the computer.
Those but, are like learning games.
Yeah. The ones that are a little like really like childhood kind of games.
If
but,
your
like,
parents
the first...
want you to play it, it doesn't count.
Well, so but I'd say yeah, the first video game I ever owned on a console that I actually bought with like a year's worth of savings with the Nintendo 64 was Super Mario 64, and so that was probably the first one there. The first one I played was Mario Kart 64. I played it at a little tech shop I think it was in San Francisco. At least this is how my memory goes. I've told my mom this story one time and she's like, that we never did that there, right?
But what but, are you talking
yeah,
about?
Yeah, but as far as my memory is concerned, we were in like a little electronic shop in San Francisco, and I remember the whole layout of the shop, like I know it in my head. And they had a little demo unit going of Mario Kart 64, and I played it and fell in love with it. And that's when I decided to buy a Nintendo 64. And so I, saved up for a while, got it, and then Super Mario 64, I think, came with it or something.
It definitely did.
So, I played that, and then I got Mario Kart 64 pretty soon after, once I could. I think my parents probably got it for me or something. But anyway, so that's, yes, I wouldn't, that wasn't on the list of, like, games that really, really got me going, but that was my first one. I guess it should be there.
So for that reason, it deserves a mention.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah.
So tell us what you're...
So I would say the first game that I ever got, like, that I ever experienced hype for, that I actually, like, waited for it to come out. Yeah. That I waited for it to come out, and then I bought it when it came out, and I loved it, was Star Fox 64.
Oh,
because
they had
a demo for that in Blockbuster. When I was checking out a Nintendo 64 game from Blockbuster...
shout out Blockbuster.
Yeah, right. Mm-hmm. They had a demo unit for Star Fox 64, and I played it. Like, I made up excuses to go to Blockbuster. Like, it was things like I would want to return this game that I was having a ton of fun with, but I wanted to return it quickly so that we could go back and I could play more Star Fox. And it was so much fun. And when the game came out, I bought it and played it, and it was fantastic. And I think that's hugely important to me now because of how big hype is. I think it's like. I think that's pretty noteworthy to say that's the first one that I got excited about before it came out.
Well, the hype was born.
Yeah. And then the other one I think is actually Kirby 64, the Crystal Shards. Because that game, I think I put the most time into that. That was the first game that I put like an insane amount of hours into. That was the first game that I knew inside and out, gotcha. Right? And since then, of course, there have been plenty of games like that. Mm. But
yeah,
but
I almost bought Kirby too. Except I was going to go Super Nintendo, but still,
me
yeah,
and Connor play the crap out of Kirby on Super Nintendo.
Kirby All Star, yep. Or Superstar, yeah. Oh,
whatever it was called. Yeah,
fist bump me.
Yeah, Plasma.
So what I loved about
dude,
it,
love it.
There was you could. When you sucked up an enemy, they had elements, right? And you could get two elements going at once. And so if you had, like,
mix
Cutter Kirby, right? And then if you had Rock Kirby, for instance, you could actually, you would sculpt yourself into statues, different statues, and you could, like, you know, use that, you know, your weight as an attack and all that.
So just, all you can combine your powers.
Yeah, and it was so, there were so many combinations to that game. I'm still pretty impressed that they added that many into the game, mm-hmm. that you could just explore and have fun and be creative and, like, you know, little the accomplishments were things like right at the very beginning of the level was the only guy in that level with that element, and then right at the end of the level was the only guy in the game with that element. So you had to, like, take this one guy's element and keep it for the whole level until you could get to that guy. So then you could have, that's the only way that you could get that one combination. And, like, nice. Then you had, it was so cool. It's like that. Because
it's like you
stuff.
Get that collector's, you know, kind of approach when you
yeah.
add that.
Yeah, and it was so fantastic. And then the multiplayer I thought was a ton of fun. I actually really think that the multiplayer would do well in today's market too if they added just that mode and like made a whole game around it. They could sell that for $15 and it would stand among Towerfall Ascension easy.
Hell yeah.
Because if anyone remembers it was like, you know, you're standing on a big grid and each player... So each player can run around this grid and you would hit, like, let's say... You're near the bottom of the grid, and you hit your hammer facing upwards, right? Then every block above you would, like, fall, right? And anyone who's standing on them would fall as well, right? Exactly. But it would also mean that no one could cross that gap. And so you could pretty much, like you could herd people into like, corners.
Traps.
And then you would, you know, they have less room to go, and then you could get rid of one row after another until they have nowhere to go. And then, but, of course, there's things they can do to counter that as well. And it was one of the best... It was the first, like, kind of complex
multiplayer
experience that I've ever really had that I got into with my friends, too. It wasn't just, like, me playing alone. It was, like... That was the first one that I had a fantastic multiplayer experience
I gotta
with.
Get on N64 and get on that, because I'm a huge Kirby fan.
It was so incredible. It really, really was.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, and I mean, at some point, especially once I get my own place, I think it'll be easier because all my stuff will be a little more centralized, and hopefully I could actually set up my 64, and then you can come over, and I mean, it's still functioning. I still have my cartridge of Crystal Shards.
We'll slam dunk it, dude.
Yeah.
We'll do it. We'll step up to the plate and slam dunk a touchdown. I heard that commercial. I can't claim it. I have to be honest.
But yeah, I'd say those are, like, probably the two that I wanted to mention.
Dude, solid, unexpected, but extremely warranted picks. If no one has any more, I was going to just mention one more that would segue into one last thing I wanted to say.
I completely forgot my Genesis days.
Oh my gosh, Sonic.
Yeah, I had a Genesis. That was pretty good. That Genesis, the Disney games like Toy Story, Aladdin, and Lion King, those were all really great games for being a kid.
Oh yeah.
But Connor could join me in this one. One time after hanging out with Connor, I came home and my dad had Quake 3.
Oh no.
And that was the beginning of those days.
That's where the flesh chunks started spraying.
Yeah.
And they haven't stopped since.
Yeah. Quake 3, and then my dad bought Unreal Tournament, and then...
So much happy gore fun time.
Yeah. That was good times.
Speaking of which, I have to throw out... This game is important, not because it shaped me as a gamer, but almost kind of like as a person. Mm-hmm. Diablo 1 on computer... I hadn't played anything even remotely close to that, except maybe Resident Evil 2 at the time, but Diablo 1 had a decidedly different feel from 2 and 3 for those who have played those but not 1. It was much more gothic, much more... The focus of the game was on kind of creeping you out and creating an atmosphere.
As
like
opposed
to
getting the loot or whatever?
As opposed to, right, killing the monsters and getting the loot.
The genre, like the gameplay is similar though, right?
Yeah, you walked much slower. You couldn't run, so it was much slower paced and kind of more... tactical, I guess, in comparison to 2 and 3, which are very much hack and slash at a high speed. But it was a very dark game. I mean, literally, like, it was hard to see. There was lots more gore and them messing with you mentally with like audio, like the songs they played were much creepier back then. Like there was actual like screams and people like gibbering madly in the background of the song and always making you. And so like, I'm a young guy. This came out in like 96, 97 if memory serves. So like I'm playing this then and like my parents clearly didn't know how much gore and how many like dark, really evil themes were in that game. Like I was 6 years old, like trying to, like raise the Lord of Evil like from the dead, you know, like, and it was just awesome. And so like ever since then, like as you guys know, I'm huge into metal. I'm huge into like games that involve fear and gore and things of a dark nature like that.
Sure.
And like it's just I enjoy it thoroughly. And I feel like being exposed to Diablo 1 at such a young age totally like shaped me in that regard. Like it gave me an appreciation for that kind of entertainment.
Sure. I never even thought of that. That makes a lot of sense, though.
I was corrupted from a young age.
I remember when he was playing Diablo 1.
So that
he was like, "Hey Nick, watch this." And I'm like, "No, I don't want to. It's too scary."
Yeah, exactly. Because like you would kill one of the invisible like I can't remember their names, the something walkers who could go invisible. You'd kill them, and they would just like fall forward under their knees, and their head would like fall off, and just like spew blood like. Until there's a giant pool around them, and you'd kill like 10 of those guys next to each other, and it's just like this giant pile of like meat and blood, and you're just like standing in the middle.
God.
And I remember just like stopping and like looking at that when I was a little kid, and probably just like frothing at the mouth, you know,
right?
Just like kill, kill it all.
Yep.
And then we'd turn it off and play the Incredible Toon Machine.
Yeah, exactly.
Yep.
Exactly. Oh, then we would watch some VeggieTales.
Is that pre-Christian VeggieTales? Because man, that stuff was awesome.
Yeah. Right. And so I wanted to use that as a segue into one thing I forgot to mention in our boss fight segment.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And just to totally bring back, and then I'm done. One of the best boss fight experiences I've ever had, and still have to this day, is the first time fighting Diablo in Diablo 2 on hardcore mode. Because he has so much damage that he throws at you so fast that like, it's basically one of those white knuckle rides that we were talking about where you're basically just making the sound.
I can't even imagine the amount of pressure, especially on hardcore mode. And I think that's what really gets me. And that's, I think that, I mean, it gets so much respect from me.
You have just to be a lunatic.
It's incredible. Like I applaud you for even getting to Diablo. Did you end up beating him?
We have a spotty track record, but many victories. But part of the thing, or part of the reason it's so tense every time is because like every character is a totally different journey, and some characters match up really well against Diablo, and some match up terribly. And so
I mean, every character like that you build, or every
class? that I build, right? Basically both. But
So.
Every time you got to Diablo and you were opening the seals to summon him, like you didn't know if it was going to go well. Like you could run up and get murdered instantly for all you knew, which has happened, by the way. And so there's just like that has to be in like my top three like boss fight experiences ever because A, you're afraid you're going to freaking die. Like you're scared for your life. Like that's what's great about hardcore is it almost gives you that like fear for your life.
Yeah.
You know? Like, and B, there's so many unknowns because you don't know if he's going to just murder you outright instantly. And C, the atmosphere of that fight is just so awesome to begin with, even without hardcore mode. You're in hell. You're in the Lord of Hell's domain, like in the pits of, you know, darkness.
Mm-hmm.
And you open these three giant pentagrammed seals, and then you go to the middle, and there's this giant flaming pentagram with lava all in it, and Diablo pops up. And next thing you know, he's running at your face, 80 miles an hour.
Yeah.
Just going, not even death can save you from me. And it's like, every time I hear that, like, my heart just kind of sinks a little bit. And I just go, oh, crap.
But I really, dude. All right. I wanted you to try something.
Oh, okay.
When
I'm
Diablo 4 comes out.
When?
Whatever the hell.
2026.
Yes. Go through the game for the first time on hardcore.
Oh, shit.
Just because I think that would be such a rush. I think it would be a rush for
That'd
you, too.
That'd be so awesome.
Because you just wouldn't know what's going to happen. You have all of this game experience. You have all of this knowledge. You were prepared for this. But,
you're so right.
But, like, you have no idea what this one's going to throw
at
you.
I'd be, like, peeking around every corner.
Right?
Just like,
but can you imagine what a fantastic experience that would be? Going through it for the first time and seeing how far you can get. And that's, like, a true how far did you get without ever
knowing
dying?
Anything?
Yeah, like, wouldn't that be nuts?
That's like as close as you can get in a video game to just real life.
Like, you should try it. I'm serious.
You don't know what's going to happen. You could die at any freaking moment.
If you should screw try up. It, though, man. Like, honestly, because I would love to see that. I think that would just be such a fantastic experience.
I'm all about it. I mean, next game that comes out that I clearly will like that has a hardcore-esque mode with one health or with one life that it gives you, I'm down. Sign me up.
Yeah.
Dude. And dude, you know what? We'll film it for the podcast.
Yeah, that'd be fantastic.
But at least you know.
Which will still be going in 2026.
Yes, it will. Absolutely. It will. But at least you know.
If I'm alive.
That God is bigger than the boogeyman.
Do I?
What?
It's a VeggieTales song.
Okay. Oh. Sorry. My VeggieTales knowledge is clearly not as expansive as yours.
We watched it all the time at school.
That was a long time ago.
Now I'm starting to get confused. Did VeggieTales start Christian and then go non-Christian?
Yes.
Yeah, I think
oh, okay.
So, yeah.
That's what it was. Because, yeah, I thought I got into it later than most people, but there was no Christian elements to it. And then,
what are they just like sacrificing like people or, like in the later VeggieTales episodes or something? I hope it gets really pagan and really violent. Yeah,
isn't it like?
No, it's just funny things.
Morals, yeah, it's like a cartoon now, right? Yeah. The new one.
I don't know if it's now, but yeah, it turned into just a thing. It was funny though. I liked it.
From fighting the Lord of Terror in the darkest pits of hell
to singing to
VeggieTales. God is bigger than the boogeyman.
Good of a segue as I can think of.
All I can, all I can remember from VeggieTales is, oh, where is my hairbrush? That's the one, dude. That's the one.
Where is my hairbrush?
Exactly.
Yeah. But pirates that don't do anything.
Yeah, true.
But that wasn't. Those weren't the Christian ones.
Yeah, they are.
Yeah, they were.
They did.
That
like
was in the Christian era, but they weren't. They didn't all have a biblical message behind them.
It was like a morality. Thing of things like teaching you a lesson.
Well, then, all right. That's fine. All right. I just never heard anyone's about God and the boogeyman and stuff.
That was the first one, one when he was watching like a Frankenstein cartoon, and he was all scared. And then they're like, "Don't worry, God's bigger than the boogeyman."
Right. Then, so video games.
Yeah.
But my favorite game of all time is that VeggieTales RPG game.
Yeah.
This
concludes VeggieTales Discussion Quarterly, the podcast that has been critically reviewed by every sector of the entertainment culture America.
What if there is a podcast that dissects every VeggieTales episode?
Then
there's a thing for everything out there. It wouldn't surprise me.
They've got my subscription.
Yep.
Speaking of which, before we abandon all of we're abandoned by all of our subscribers, shall we close out the episode?
Yeah.
An episode that has been chock full of free discussion and
this is actually really nice.
No,
like, you know, it wasn't as much structure.
This is the nostalgia episode.
I
love me some nostalgia.
Yeah. Unofficial.
Plus
VeggieTales.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I guess that
episode title right there.
I guess that concludes our podcast for the week. I hope you enjoyed our discussions. Please, especially this episode, weigh in.
Absolutely.
Tell us some of your favorite boss fights and some of the games that shaped you as a gamer. For the people who are listening, I just pointed at you authoritatively. So thank you very much again for listening, and we will see you next week from all your friends at LHG. All
right.
Peace out.
Bye, guys.
See ya.
If you like JRPGs and anime, be sure to check out The Gaming Shelf and support Taylor and all his awesome videos.
Thank you, everyone who listens and supports the podcast. If you like what you watch and want to support us, be sure to check us out on Patreon. Please leave a comment and subscribe for more gaming videos. We'll be back next Wednesday. See you there.